are bringing this event to you today in partnership with the League of Women Voters and WRLR 98.3 FM. This afternoon's candidate forum is designed to provide you information from primary sources on your way to becoming informed citizens in an informed electorate, which is part of our mission to provide current information, formal education support, independent learning, opportunities and life enrichment materials to a highly diverse public, and to nurture a lifelong reading environment. I'd like to extend some thank yous to the Round Lake Beach Cultural and Civic Center. They have offered this space to us free of charge today. The Cultural and Civic Center offers a variety of events for social gatherings, for community events, and other activities, so please feel free to get in touch with them. They've done a fantastic job of helping us out today, so thank you to the Village of Round Lake Beach for this venue. I'd also like to extend a thank you to the League of Women Voters. The League of Women Voters has partnered with the library for a number of years to bring a variety of candidates forum to our community. And today we have Diane Sanderson with us, who is handling all the coordination for today's events. We also have Lori Miller, who will be moderating for us in just a moment. Thank you to WRLR 98.3. They are broadcasting this live today and will rebroadcast this later. Comcast Local Channel 17 will be rebroadcasting this event as well. I'd like to thank our candidates. I know that all of you put a lot of time, money, energy, effort, and even bring your families and friends into this, and it is a lot of work. So thank you all for your attempt to bring our community to a better place and for dedicating your time to service in our area. Thank you very much. My final thank you is to you. This is a Sunday afternoon when we could all be home enjoying nap time or sporting events or spending time with our families or friends. I thank you all for showing an interest in our community and coming out to take a time to listen to our candidates. Thank you. A couple of final notes before I hand this over to Lori. This event is not a debate. This event is designed to provide residents the opportunity to get a first-person response from our candidates. This event is for everyone, and it's expected that everyone will be respectful of others and avoid argumentative tones in the discussion. This is a nonpartisan activity presented by nonpartisan organizations. None of the organizations hosting this event support any candidate or ballot issue. The opinions of any candidates do not reflect the views of any of the organizations today. Candidates showing up today on stage are in contested races only for the March primary. All right, now it is time to get to the excitement of our event. We're going to have Lori Miller from the League of Women Voters moderating today. Lori comes to us with a bachelor's degree from San Diego State University and a master's in information systems from Morse Central College. She's a financial planner from Wheaton and has come all the way from Wheaton today. Thank you very much to help moderate today's event. Thank you, Lori.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for having us here today. Democracy is not a spectator sport. Tim had mentioned there's a lot of opportunity today to stay home and just take a relaxing afternoon, but we applaud you for taking time out of your busy schedules. You have choices, and you have choices on quality candidates, too, in contested races, and we want to make sure your voice is heard. The League of Women Voters, as Tim had mentioned, we're the largest nonpartisan organization working to progress public policy, and that's important. We want to keep it fair and transparent. And the League of Women Voters, we do like men, so we just keep the historical perspective with our name because we started back in 1920, and organizing women, getting them to right to vote is really important. So I want to make sure that you get out, get your voice heard, work with us at the grassroots level, and ask your questions. I've already been handed some cards with questions to ask our candidates today, but it's really important that you find one of the League volunteers to get your thoughts heard. That's why you're here today. And this is the best example of grassroots at work, working with the League of Women Voters for transparency and fairness for these candidates. So I'd like them to come up to the stage, and I'm going to give them up to 1 minute to introduce themselves. And before I do that, I just want to suggest that there's going to be some ground rules on how we're going to participate. Yes, you are coming up. Nancy Rottering is coming here, and I believe she is running along with Brad Schneider for the Democratic nomination for the 10th District to represent us in the U.S. House of Representatives. So thank you, candidates, in advance for your willingness to serve in this capacity. We do appreciate that. Some of the ground rules we're going to be operating with today, the questions will be asked in writing. That does give our league members an opportunity to screen the questions because we do not allow personal attacks or attacks that aren't really relevant to the officer asking to serve for. So we want to make sure those are screened and also to make sure that we have a fair representation of the actual questions and issues that are on your mind. So we have the right to reserve for redundancy and time purposes to make sure we don't ask a lot of duplicate questions and to cover a variety of subject areas. They will have up to 1.5 minutes for their opening remarks, and Nancy did win the draw, so she will make her comments first, and then Brad will have his opening remarks up to 1.5 minutes. Then they'll reverse that for their closing comments. And depending on how much time is left over, we will ask all your questions. That is important, like I said, so it's not too late to get those pencils out and start writing those down. And then they have a mic at the table, so if you feel comfortable coming to the podium, you're invited to do that as well. But at this time, I'd like to go ahead and get started if there's no further questions. And I would like to ask in advance and thank you for your cooperation for not personally videotaping this and using it out of context. Again, the league promotes fairness and transparency. And we do have our capable partners, both in radio and with Comcast here, to have this for public viewing and public vetting in a more controlled structure. So thank you so much for participating in that. With that, Nancy?
Thank you, Lori. Thank you, Jim. Thank you to the League of Women Voters. As a proud member of the League, I recognize the vital importance of these opportunities for voters to be educated about the candidates that they're considering. As Lori mentioned, and also I want to thank the Round Lake High School National Honor Society for being here. Thanks so much for your help today. My name is Nancy Rotering. I grew up in the district. I went to public school. I went to Stanford, where I majored in economics, and then got my MBA at Northwestern and my law degree at the University of Chicago. I practiced healthcare law with McDermott, Will & Emery for a number of years and became a member of the Highland Park City Council in 2009 and ran for mayor in 2011. As mayor, I've balanced every budget. I've maintained a AAA bond rating, but I've also stepped out on behalf of my residents when they've needed me in situations that aren't typical in municipalities. We all suffered through the power outages of 2011, and we called ComEd, had hearings, demanded accountability, and ended up getting tens of millions of dollars invested in our infrastructure and improved communications to reduce our power outages and the impacts of those power outages. When the NRA packed my city council chambers, we stood up against them and we banned assault weapons with an ordinance that was taken all the way to the United States Supreme Court and then handed that out to other cities within the country looking for a model ordinance. The 10th District is looking for leadership. We have a lot of opportunities, and it's time for somebody who knows how to get things done to win this seat and hold this seat in 2018. Thank you.
Thank you so much. At this time, I'd like to invite Brad Schneider to come and make his opening comments.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Brad Schneider, and I am running to get back to the U.S. Congress to represent the 10th District, and I'm asking for your vote on March 15th. I was reminded, actually, today as we did the national anthem, of the last time I was here with this configuration, with the room cut in half, was a citizenship ceremony we had organized to welcome 53 new U.S. citizens for the first time to say the national anthem, or to the Pledge of Allegiance as a U.S. citizen. That's just one of the reasons I want to get back to Congress, to fight to make sure that we have representation for all of the people living in our communities. My number one focus when I was in Congress, now as I'm running and when I get back to Congress, is making sure, however, that we have an economy that's working for everybody. An economy that raises the tide for all boats, not just those of the fortunate few. That gets us back to a middle class that's expanding. That's why when I was in Congress, I voted to raise the minimum wage. Why I introduced legislation that would teach our workforce the skills manufacturers are looking. There are 600,000 jobs in this country going unfilled because we don't have people with the right skills. Introduced legislation that would help companies in our district hire people and provide them on-the-job training so we could get people in the right places. I'm running for Congress to continue the work we started. I look forward to your support, and I look forward to a conversation today. Thank you very much.
I'm sure you notice our timers sitting in the front row. They have stop signs, and it just like a traffic light, yield means yellow. You've got a few more seconds to wrap up that thought, and then the stop sign means do complete that thought, and you'll get a nudge from me, and I'm sure the audience will give you a nudge, too, if you go past that time. And just like a budget item, a time is a scarce resource. You have up to 1 minute to answer each question. And some of those questions, because I know they're going to get very challenging, you can put those into your closing comments. And of course, the candidates will make themselves available during the break period today to answer your questions, and I'm sure they encourage your dialogue after this. But we're gonna go ahead and start our community conversation today with our first question. We're gonna start with candidate Schneider, and then we'll rotate order. What is your stand on the extension of the deadline for the state's ratification of the Equal Rights Amendment?
Thank you. I do believe we can extend and work to pass the ERA. When I mentioned 1979, when I was in high school and college, when Nancy and I were in high school and college, we're the same year, it was the push to try to move forward on the ERA. I remember going down to downtown Chicago with my classmates at Northwestern, walking, working, marching to try to make sure that we could get into our Constitution recognition that everybody's equal. This is a precept that I was raised from a very young age. My grandmother, who immigrated from pre-Soviet Russia, fleeing the pogroms, came to this country. She was the wisest person I know. She taught us a few lessons. One piece of wisdom was you have two ears, one mouth, use them in proportion. But probably the most valuable lesson she taught all of her 18 grandchildren, and we hopefully have passed on to her 30-plus great-grandchildren, is that you treat all people the same. That this country recognizes you for who you are, as you are. And that's why we need an Equal Rights Amendment.
Thank you. As obviously a woman, I've had my share of experiences in this country of where an ERA being passed would have had a tremendous impact. And we know, just even now, the conversation as we look at this presidential race, we know that Hillary Clinton said in Beijing, women's rights are human rights and human rights are women's rights. It's not a matter of half of the population not being treated fairly. It's a matter of all of us needing to be treated equally and making sure that issues such as wage, taking care of affordable childcare, making sure that healthcare accessibility is available to all people regardless of gender, that there aren't biases built into the system, that we need to move forward in terms of equaling the playing field because there are so many opportunities lost when we don't have equality in our system. Thank you.
Thank you, candidate. I'm waiting on fresh batteries. The next question, and we'll start with you, candidate Rottering. Citizens United, what is your view? If you agree with it, then why? If you don't agree with it, then what are you willing to do about it?
I'm gonna make one correction. My last name is Rotering, like motoring, so just wanted to help you out with there. Thanks, that doesn't count. in terms of Citizens United, it's the scourge, one of the scourges of our political system. It never should have been allowed to carry in the Supreme Court, and has now set up an absolutely impossible situation for anybody who's interested in running for office. We know that we can't have representative government if we have dark money, if we have a handful of people providing the resources necessary for people to run for office. I co-taught a class at the University of Chicago on women in politics, and one of the questions was, what advice would you have for a single mother who wanted to run for office? And the answer was, it's going to be very difficult because the way the system currently is set up, it's very difficult for anybody to run along these lines when you're facing this kind of corporate money and these special interests standing up and providing resources for people in the system. So I would oppose it. I think the answer, if we can't get through the Supreme Court, would be a constitutional amendment. It's that important. It's that critical to make sure that the people running to represent you can have the resources to talk to you. Thank you.
Nancy and I obviously agree on this. I think the Citizens United, historians will look back on that as one of the worst Supreme Court decisions ever made in this country. It is distorting our entire political process and is having a seriously negative effect on governance in this country. Just to give you an example, this summer, we've winnowed down the number of candidates, but this summer when there were 17 Republican presidential candidates, each with their own billionaire backing them, there were more Republican candidates with billionaires backing them than there were candidates Can you hear me? Than there were candidates running for Congress in competitive races in the entire country. And both those factors are a function of Citizens United. The fact that individuals can support a candidate with unlimited funds, billionaires can actually put a person in office, and at the same time, in our local races, you can't raise the funds to compete. We need to overturn Citizens United. I'm proud to be endorsed by Citizens United as well. Thank you.
Thank you. This is why I'm standing. The next question, we're switching topics. What should the federal government do to reduce gun violence? And Candidate Schneider, we'll start with you.
Thank you. This is a personal issue. Many of you know that I'm named after my mother's uncle, my great uncle, who was killed by an assailant with a gun before I was born. When I got to Congress in 2013, the first speech I gave from the floor of the House, in spite of or despite all of the warnings of my colleagues and friends saying you don't take on the most powerful lobby in Washington on your first speech as a freshman member, but I spoke about what we can do to reduce gun violence in this country. We need to enforce and create universal background checks, closing the gun show loophole, the online loophole. We need to make trafficking of guns across state lines a federal crime. We need to make sure that people can't have access to assault weapons and large capacity magazines so they can walk into a movie theater and fire 70 bullets in less than a minute. But it's got to be more comprehensive than that as well. 90 people will die today from gunshots, 90 tomorrow and 90 the next day. Two-thirds of those will take their own lives. There's an aspect of this crisis in our country that is also a mental health aspect, and we have to address that as well.
Unfortunately, we've had yet another mass shooting today, and this is more apt than ever. It's becoming too regular a piece of news, and it's something that needs to end. We need Congress to turn around and change this conversation and stop being beholden to the NRA. There's plenty that the government can do. We can pass universal background checks. We can close down and enforce the handful of dealers who don't seem to be feeling like they need to follow the law, resulting in an unbelievable large volume of illegal guns coming to our streets from just a few dealers, a few states. We do need to talk about improving access to mental health care because we know that so many people are using guns who really would benefit from treatment and would perhaps not take their lives or the lives of others if they had had access to health care. I took action. We banned all assault weapons in Highland Park. It was a challenge to deal with the NRA calling us Nazis in the middle of our own council chambers, but we knew it was the right thing to do. And it's time for the U.S. government to step forward and say no more to assault weapons and large capacity magazines.
Thank you, candidates. I appreciate your thoughtful answers. The next question is, again, changing topics. What are your plans to ensure that the less affluent citizens of your district have the food, shelter, and medical care that they need? Candidate Nancy?
It's critical to have an advocate when you don't have a voice. It's critical to have a champion who will stand up and say, we need to take care of our neighbors. We need to take care of our communities. We've watched as the Republican Party has nibbled away through its various budgets and so forth at the very critical safety nets that are there to take care of our hungry, the people who don't have housing, the people who don't have access to safe neighborhoods. This is something that I've championed as a mayor. We've shined a spotlight on hunger in Highland Park and in the region. We've provided affordable housing, and I am a committed advocate on behalf of all of those pieces. We need to make sure that those safety nets are not taken apart, are not destroyed. There's talk about balancing the budget. You can't balance the budget on the backs of the vulnerable. That's absolutely the wrong place to be balancing the budget of this government. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Brad?
Thank you. So the Republicans continue to pass what we all affectionately call the Ryan budget. It's a budget that cuts funding, cuts $120 billion from the SNAP program, the food support, food stamp program, at a time where food insecurity continues to be at the high it went to in the 2008 crisis. I was proud to be in Congress fighting against those Republican efforts, fighting to make sure we protect the tax credits that allow for affordable housing to be continued to developed and built around our nation. And I continue to fight against the Republican efforts, and they continue since I've left, to repeal, defund, or dismantle the Affordable Care Act. We have to keep all of those things in place. And that's the difference between the candidates on the stage now and the person currently in office, and why we have to make that change. It is so important. But we also have to work to strengthen our communities, to build our economy,
to bring manufacturing jobs back, quality, well-paying jobs, so people can afford to put a roof over their head, provide food, shelter, health care, and education to their children, and can be guaranteed the opportunity for secure and dignified retirement. Thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead and keep the mic. And mine's working now. Yay. Thank you. And this is not a trick question. And Candidate Schneider, you'll go first. What do you think Congress has done right lately?
It's a tough question. I'm going to flip it. I will come to answer that. But right now, you see in its rawest, most naked form the problem in Congress with the appointment of a new Supreme Court justice upon the death of Antonin Scalia. We elect our presidents for 4 years, not for three. And the news of the Supreme Court justice's death was probably less than an hour old before Mitch McConnell came out and said, we are not going to allow the president to nominate and appoint a Supreme Court justice. That's just plain wrong. It is his prerogative and his duty, and he should appoint a justice, and the Senate should have a hearing. Having said that, we have seen over the last couple of years steps where, oftentimes forced by a crisis, the parties have come together. I will tell you, having been there, it's been under the leadership of Nancy Pelosi. John Boehner often had to turn to the Democrats to get it done. But in 2013, we did pass a budget for the first time in 4 years. And last year, they passed a budget again. But it's been under the leadership of the Democrats, not the controlling Republicans.
Thank you. And I echo, it's critical that the president be able to appoint a Supreme Court justice, having watch this from a close distance. Jean Scalia was a law school classmate of mine. What Congress has done right lately, frankly, there's been one piece of legislation that I was delighted to see, and that was the FAST Act, that was finally putting some sort of money into investing in our infrastructure. This is something that I've done as a mayor. We know that it impacts public safety and public health, and most particularly in this district, transportation and transit and the ability to get around is vitally important. It's been one of the major issues that we've talked about while we've been walking through the campaign trail, and I applaud the fact that they moved ahead with the FAST Act. That being said, I feel that they need to find a better way of continuing to support it. It's necessary to have the funding, not just for 5 years in a sort of Band-Aid approach that Congress has passed, but it's critical and vitally important to invest in our infrastructure and to make sure that that's something that cities and states, as well as the federal government, can plan on for the next 20 years and on.
Thank you, candidate. Candidate Nancy, do you support the expansion of Route 53 north to Route 120 in the southwest corner of the county?
So this is one of those questions where you look at public policy and you say there needs to be a balance. I just talked about the needs, the transportation needs, the challenges that face this portion of the district, and fully recognize that that could have a tremendous impact on a number of people. But that being said, I've also been an environmental advocate for a number of years, and I'm concerned about the impact that the expansion of 53 might have on environmentally sensitive areas. And I also know from a fiscal standpoint that I haven't really seen how this pays for itself and how this burden economically is shared. I've asked Chairman Lawler, and I've asked Dave Stolman, the treasurer of Lake County, to please put cameras in their finance committee meetings so we can watch and understand better the analysis that's gone into this question. They haven't agreed. And so onward we trudge, waiting to get a better understanding of the true fiscal impact of putting this road in place.
Thank you. Candidate Schneider?
Thank you. So how many people here have had to drive on 120 west to east during rush hour or east to west during rush hour? You understand the problem. But the problem's an east-west problem, and Route 53 is a north-south solution. And as Nancy touched on poignantly as well, the funding mechanisms aren't really clear, and the environmental impact is of great concern. I think this is the wrong solution for the problems we face. That doesn't mean we turn our back on the problem. We have to address the problem. The FAST Act was an important step, but as Nancy noted, it was not funded in the most transparent way, I guess would be the nice way to say it. We have to think and rethink transportation in this entire county, using mass transit, buses and rail, so people are moving and off of our roads, building our communities so people can work and play and live without having to rely on driving long distances in oppressive traffic. We have to address it, but I'm concerned that Route 53 is not the right way.
Thank you. Candidate Brad, you'll answer this first. In Flint, Michigan, an emergency manager made final fiscal decisions that later had grave impacts on the community. Is your alliance to the party more important than your alliance to the constituents? Give an example where you stepped up for the citizens.
Thank you. No, I think all 435 representatives are sent to Washington to represent everybody in their district. In the 10th district, that's about 730,000 people. It doesn't matter if you're Democrat, Republican, you voted for me or against me, I represent everyone in this district. I represent the communities of this district and the interests and priorities and values of this district. I did that when I was in Washington. There were some hard choices. A perfect example I will use is there was a bill passed before I got to Congress called the Biggert Waters Act. It dealt with flood insurance. It was going to increase the cost of flood insurance to many of the people living in this area. We were talking about Fox Lake. It would have devastated many of the homeowners in Fox Lake, right? Sierra Club was asking us not to vote it. Others were asking us, the party was not supporting, but I felt we should not increase at such a quick rate on the families who were living in these homes and would not be able to afford their home and their insurance. We had to do it at a different rate, and I voted to do just that.
Thank you. Candidate Nancy?
Thank you. As a mayor who has put infrastructure at one of the top three priorities of my city, this would have never happened. And it's a criminal situation when somebody makes a decision to let down the very people that they've been elected to take care of, to provide public safety and public health for. When the opportunity came before Congress, though, to provide emergency funds to help in this situation, for whatever reason, they chose not to provide those funds. I think that's why it's vitally important to consider having somebody who's been a mayor for 5 years, who has dealt with these decisions day in and day out, to understand the very real impacts that are made in Washington and how they affect people. Our hearts are with the people of Flint. I think it's a bigger question that's going to need to be examined across the country with a number of aged pipelines, and it's something that I plan to make a priority.
Thank you, candidates. The next question is going to ask your thoughts, and it's one of those balancing issues of Apple security versus the Federal Bureau of Investigation with privacy concerns. Your thoughts on that? And we'll start with candidate Nancy.
Thank you. What's interesting to me about this question is that the law that's being taken into consideration is over 200 years old. And so while to us it feels acute and fresh and scary and new, it really is something that this country has faced throughout clearly centuries. We need to maintain the security of our nation. Our homeland has to be absolutely protected. That being said, I have very real concerns also about protecting the civil liberties of our residents and making sure that their privacy is protected. So I recognize, to your point, the balance between maintaining security and also maintaining those liberties. When you start to unencrypt things, when you start to create backdoors, there are unintended consequences, and others can hack into security systems, others can gain access to information that they have no business gaining information from. So it is a difficult one. I would like to see us work through other modes to get that information. We know that that data is available in the cloud, and I think that's a good approach for the FBI.
Thank you. Canada Brad?
This may be where there is a difference. The law of all writs, the 1789 law that is being used to try to persuade Apple to open the phone, doesn't necessarily deal with technology. We need to have a conversation in our country about protecting our civil liberties, which we must, and protecting our security, which we also must. We are a smart nation. There's no reason we can't do both of those things and hold them in balance. I believe Apple has a responsibility to national security. Okay, they're not being asked to create a backdoor to all phones. It's this one specific phone. They're being asked to not, the data is not available on the cloud. If you know, if you have an Apple phone, you have your 4-digit key. After 10 tries, all of that data is wiped out. That's why the government has gone to Apple to say, help us break through on this phone and this phone only and destroy it. What they've done, and this is why it's important that we have the balance, they've gone to the court, a judge has ruled that they can have this information. We have to maintain that balance.
Thank you, Candidate Brad. And you will answer this question next. Switching topics, do you believe that illegal immigrants should receive legal status? And what are your thoughts on immigration?
Let me take it a step further. If we could pass one piece of legislation tomorrow, it should be comprehensive immigration reform. It is long overdue. I was proud when I was in Congress to introduce that legislation. Had John Boehner brought it to the floor and allowed a vote, I believe that it would have passed overwhelmingly with Democratic and Republican support. Why is it so important? There are 11 million people living in this country today who are living in the shadows. If we pass immigration reform with a pathway to citizenship, with protection of the Dreamers, those people will be an increased part of our communities, starting businesses, buying homes, kids going to college, graduating and working in our economy, starting businesses, adding new jobs. The Congressional Budget Office, a nonpartisan organization, estimates that passing immigration reform will add $2 trillion to our economy over the next two decades and reduce our debt by $170 billion, allowing us to fund some of the other programs so important to us. So not only do I support immigration reform, but I think it's one of the most important things we can do as a country.
Thank you, candidate. Candidate Nancy.
We are a proud nation of immigrants. All of us can think of our grandfathers, our great-grandfathers and grandmothers, and or our own parents who have come here from another country and brought unbelievable gifts that have made us a nation of proud individuals, people who can contribute a whole broad range of great information to moving us forward. I'm a strong supporter of comprehensive immigration reform. There are 11 million people living in the shadows who should be able to feel comfortable coming to school, going to the doctor, being a part of our economy, being welcome in our communities. As a mayor, I created a legal aid clinic in Highland Park, recognizing the needs of my immigrant families who did not feel quite as though they were able to go to the health clinic, the Lake County Health Clinic. So we now provide free legal services to our residents on their path to citizenship. It's vitally important that this is something that's passed by our Congress. Again, enough of the name calling. It's time to move our nation forward, not backwards.
Thank you. The next question is dealing with election contributions. We'll have one more question after this and then move to closing comments. So thank you for your thoughtful questions. There's lots and we're trying to get all the areas covered. So the question is this: how to finance elections with transparency with the corporations and union contributions? Should we have spending limits on all money spent on campaigns?
As we talked about earlier when we talked about Citizens United, the never-ending drive and requirement to raise ridiculous sums of money really limits the number of people who can run for office. And as a result, we really have a disrepresentative government. We really don't have the voices of the majority being heard because most people cannot move forward. We've seen a small number of women actually in office because of a lack of ability to raise money and so forth. So I would heartily support limits on campaign spending. I think it evens the playing field and it gives us the opportunity to hear from far more people who would be excellent candidates in this realm. In terms of whether it's public money or private money, I believe if it came from one source, everybody would have access to the same resources. Everybody would have the opportunity to spend more time talking to the voters and working with people on the campaign trail and not spending hours on end sitting in an office calling random people for money.
Thank you, candidate. Candidate Brad.
Thank you. The last effort at comprehensive campaign finance reform was McCain-Feingold a generation ago. It has been whittled away, and as we have already talked about, Citizens United, that court decision has essentially wiped out any limits on campaign finance. The presidential race is going to cost upwards of $2 billion. It's an extraordinary number. House races are now costing multi-millions, as Nancy talked about. We need to figure out a better way to do this. It's got to come from Congress, the House and the Senate working together, to say we need people's voices back in our elections. A colleague of mine, John Sarbanes, has introduced legislation. Some of the ideas, and I support that, some of the ideas that he talks about there is a matching program that for donations under $100 or $150, government will fund taxpayers by checking off a box on their tax return, can fund that at six times the number. So a $100 contribution could generate $600 or $700. That's a step in the right direction. But we also have to get away from two-year campaigns and bring the focus back to governing.
Thank you, candidates. And here's your final question. Candidate Brad, we'll start with you. How would you address the challenges of finding appointment for those over and under 50?
I didn't hear the finding.
This is a little.
No, I just didn't hear the word. Finding what?
Finding employment,
for
those over 40 and 50.
This is one of the challenges we've seen in our economy. And, you know, people my age, we're 54, our age, when we graduated high school, we were told you're not getting a defined contribution plan or a defined benefit plan. You get a defined contribution plan. Put money into a 401k. Put money into a Section 529 to pay for your kid's school. Buy a home. Take out a mortgage. And everything would work fine. But in 2007, 2008, when our kids were graduating high school and going to college, the market tanked. And people were having to take money out of their 401k, having to take money out of their, couldn't take money out of their home, and then they lost their job, and they're still looking for a job. We need to get our economy growing back again. I'll talk more about this in my closing remarks. We've got to have our economy growing for the middle class, not just the fortunate few. Jobs where the people with skills that made sense a generation ago can learn skills that make sense for the 21st century, not just young people, but across the age spectrum. Opportunities for people to work and secure the funds necessary for a dignified and secure retirement. That's what I want to work on, and that's what I'll work on when I get back to Congress.
Thank you, candidate. Candidate Nancy?
Thank you. So the question was assisting people over the age of 40 and 50 in finding employment, and so I'll speak to that. Thank
Correct.
You. We know that, I hate to call us seniors, but I guess we could kind of, we're almost seniors, middle age, keeps moving up, bring incredible experience and incredible resources and incredible perspectives that really get lost when we aren't included in the employment force. Part of the challenge is keeping corporations here so that we don't watch jobs go overseas. Part of the challenge also is providing community clearinghouses so that we can bring those who need people together with those who need jobs. And lastly, we have opportunities in our schools. Our schools are suffering right now from a decrease in resources. We were talking earlier about the challenges of not having enough resources in our schools. To be able to bring people in, perhaps at part-time, but nonetheless to give them those opportunities to serve our communities and to serve our students is something that I would strongly support.
Thank you, candidates. Thank you for your thoughtful answers. And a word I learned today is masters instead of seniors. So shows experience, but not doesn't tell your age. With that, I would like to invite candidate Brad to make his up to 1 minute closing remark. And please use the podium.
Thank you, Lori. I want to thank the League of Women Voters for having this event and this great opportunity to present our thoughts and ideas to you. I'm running for Congress, as I said before, because I want to finish the work I started 4 years ago. I want to work to get our economy growing for all of us, not just that fortunate few. That's why when I was in office, we changed the name from job fairs to hiring fairs, because every employer who came to those made a promise to us that they would hire at least one person who came and gave them a resume. We had them all around the district, including here in Round Lake. That's why we have to work locally in our communities to help them to get jobs for people who are laid off in those master years, as we're calling it. Right? But I want to make sure that we also are focusing on education, that every child here has the opportunity to get a quality education, regardless of the zip code. I had a chance to speak to five of the honor students here and hear about their dreams and ambitions. Every child should be able to pursue their ambitions in this country. They deserve it, but we need it. And that's why I'm running for Congress. I'm running for Congress to continue the work. I look for your support, and I thank you for giving us this time today.
Thank you, candidate Brad.
Thank you.
Candidate Nancy?
Thanks again for the chance to talk with you this afternoon. I'm running on a record of advocacy and achievement. We know that the 10th District is full of opportunities and really needs somebody who is able to step forward and take action from day one. We've watched as Bob Dold has nibbled around the edges of very hard-fought fights that we all feel are very, very important to us. So I'm offering you somebody with a background in business and in law who's held elected office now for 7 years, who knows how to be the champion for constituents on matters that are very important to each of us, whether it's healthcare, whether it's education, the environment, jobs, fair wages, you name it. As we travel this district, we see so many opportunities. We haven't had that champion. My name is Nancy Rotering. I'm running for United States Congress. I ask for your support and your vote on March 15th. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, candidates, for your willingness to serve. Good luck with your races. And thank you, audience, for being here and for your thoughtful questions today. At this time, we will recess for approximately 5 minutes, and I'd like to invite you back to listen to the discussions we're going to have with the Lake County State's Attorney's races. So thank you. Thank you so much for staying and being with us for the second half of our program today. Again, today we're having a community conversation with those willing to step up and serve us citizens here for Lake County for the state's attorney's race. On behalf of the League of Women Voters, we're excited to have you here. We're excited that we have the National Honor Society for Round Lake High School helping out with today's event. And we're grateful for our participating partners with the radio station and also with Comcast. And we look forward to you reviewing this on the rebroadcast are going to start next Sunday. So thanks. For the next half hour, we're going to have a conversation regarding the Lake County State's Attorney's race and what the issues are. So truly, make sure you see one of these volunteers. Take one of the white index cards. Put your questions on it. Get it to our question sorters. They'll make sure they get it to me so we can ask your questions. So thank you for willing to be informed constituents and getting out to exercise that right to vote here now for early and grace period voting, and then also for also for the actual primary, which is going to be on March 15th. With that, we've already had a discussion and drew numbers to see the order of who's making open comments first. And our two candidates for the Democratic ticket for the Lake County State's Attorney's race are Michael J. Perillo Jr. and also Matt Stanton. And Matt, I do believe that you got the opportunity to go first. So I'd like to invite you to the podium and make to a 1.5 minute opening comment.
My name is Matt Stanton. I'm running for the office of state's attorney for one primary purpose, and that's to restore public trust in the state's attorney's office. I plan to do that by demanding accountability of every employee with the commitment that no one will go to prison for a crime they did not commit, and no one will escape justice for a crime that they did commit. I think the office needs to be restructured. A little bit about myself. This is the first time that I'm running for office. In the 1980s, I started out my working life at O'Hare Airport as an airline mechanic. By the early 1990s, I had become a single parent of five children. As you can imagine, that was a busy existence, and I went to school. I went to college in the 1990s when my kids were old enough for me to be out of for me to go away to night school. That's what I did. We came home, we hit the books together. 16 years ago, I made the decision to go to law school. I've been a practicing attorney, an educator. I'm also a law professor at one of the law schools as an adjunct. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, candidate. Candidate Michael.
Thank you, and let me start out by thanking the League and the Library and everyone else who's involved in putting on this program. It is certainly a great opportunity and a privilege to speak with all of you about the state's attorney's race. My name is Mike Perillo. I'm a candidate for the Democratic nomination for Lake County State's Attorney. I seek the office because I seek the privilege of public service. And if elected, I will provide Lake County with the best state's attorney's office in the state of Illinois. By way of background, I've been a practicing attorney for over 32 years. I started out as a Navy JAG lawyer here at Great Lakes in the middle 1980s. In that capacity, I prosecuted court-martial cases, and I was also in an administrative role at one of the school's commands over here. After that, I was a felony assistant in the Lake County Public Defender's Office. And after that, I was a felony assistant right here in the Lake County State's Attorney's Office. Since 1992, I've been in private practice here in Waukegan. All of my 32 years of legal practice have been here in Lake County, and I've lived here for all of those 32 years. Again, I thank you for being here. I ask for your vote and for the opportunity to serve. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates, for your opening comments. Now we'll get to the heart of today's discussion and communication conversation, and we'll ask the questions that are important to you. We'll start with the first question, and candidate Michael, you'll go first. What do you believe is the most important responsibility of the Lake County State's Attorney?
The most important responsibility is getting it right the first time. We've had, unfortunately, a history in Lake County of wrongful convictions. I will certainly make that, the avoidance of wrongful convictions, my first and foremost priority. In that regard, I have proposed an in-house conviction integrity unit, which would be a full-time unit in the office. The unit would be staffed by an attorney, a paralegal, an investigator, and the unit would have the opportunity to draw on all the resources of the office. It would be a threefold task: to review older cases, to ensure conviction integrity, to learn from the mistakes of the past, to monitor new cases to make sure those mistakes are not repeated, and thirdly, to engage in training in-house and hopefully for investigators outside of the office, again, to ensure that those types of mistakes are not repeated in the future.
The most important responsibility is to show and exercise immediately courage and moral leadership in an office, as Mr. Perillo has said, is so, where so much wrongful prosecutions have come out of. Now, a lot of those were built in the previous administration to Mr. Narum, who's the incumbent, but Mr. Narum has, out of inheriting the 144 employees that he inherited, he did not replace a single one. It is not a reform to release an innocent person when that's proven to you. What is a reform is to replace those individuals, that cast of characters that's consistently coming forward with these wrongful prosecutions. There has to be a hard look at the existing attorneys, and there has to be some replacements made.
Thank you, candidates. Go ahead and hang on to the mic. I just realized I am a mom, and my boys are Matt and Mike. So I am going to have to defer to your last name. So
which one's your favorite?
I think you parents out there can appreciate.
They're both favorites, right?
Absolutely.
I know.
A mother never chooses. So second question, candidate Stanton, what can the state's attorney do to prevent crime?
Well, I think an important role of the state's attorney is to address recidivism, which is preventing repeat crime. And there are different programs. There is a drug court that we currently have in Lake County that I would favor developing more and expanding that. There is also a deferred prosecution program that's been put in place under state law that I favor adopting here in Lake County that involves first-time nonviolent felonies, which basically allows supervision for those felonies. It requires the participation of the victim and the sheriff's department, the policing departments, and the judiciary. But it allows those first-time nonviolent felons to potentially expunge their case, which makes it easier for them if they've completed all the conditions and they have to be at work and in school and or to reintegrate into society.
Thank you. Candidate Stanton?
Perillo.
Oh, Perillo, sorry. Thank you, Candidate Stanton.
The prevention of crime, I believe, is twofold. I agree that certainly we need to prevent recidivism, and there are programs in place here in Lake County which address that. I certainly support them all. I would certainly look to enhance all of those programs. But beyond that, I believe that certain crime is prevented by strong and tough prosecution. Crimes committed with handguns and firearms need to be dealt with severely. I think we need to show in Lake County that we're serious about that. And if elected, I would certainly take a zero tolerance approach to any type of crimes committed with firearms or handguns.
Thank you, Candidate Perillo. Go ahead and hang on to that. The next question deals with child support and visitation issues. Those issues can be particularly complicated situations. Do you have any comments on dealing with this aspect of the job?
Not in particular, no. I do believe, I know the state's attorney's office gets involved in child support and child support enforcement, and I would certainly want to take a very hard look at that. Nothing's more important than our kids. I have a daughter. We all know how important our children are, and we know how important it is to have the financial means to take care of our children. So what I would say in answer to the question is I would take a hard look at that, and I would make sure that our office is doing everything possible to see that children are getting the support court-ordered that they need and deserve.
Thank you, candidate. Candidate Stanton?
Yes, the state's attorney does have a child support enforcement division, and they are some of the attorneys working there, is an area especially where I think experienced attorneys benefit us, having them in the Child Support Enforcement Division, that is available to citizens regardless of a means test, if you are owed child support. The one development that I've seen, and I don't know if it's a rule or if it's just a judicial between the state's attorney's office and the judiciary, is lately the child support questions are being handled separate and apart from other extenuating circumstances like visitation and other problems like that. I would favor a way to have those cases integrated into the whole of the divorce case. It would take some examination to do that. Clearly, these are complex areas. I do believe the state has a role, an important role, in the collection of child support.
Thank you, candidate. The next question is dealing with the county of reversals. Lake County is perceived by many as the county of reversals. Judges have suggested prosecutorial misconduct or incompetence as a cause. How would you approach to the office address these issues?
This is a very difficult question and how to resolve it. I think it's sometimes moral leadership means taking the harder position when you could take an easier one. There, I think the first thing to look at in this office is who are the people that are consistently involved in the wrongful prosecutions. All of the big wrongful prosecutions of recent years that have resulted in so much loss to the taxpayers, Jerry Hobbs, Juan Rivera, James Edwards, Bernie Starks, these cases, these involved the actual innocence. These people were released because they were actually innocent. The other thing that went, that was common thread, is they all confessed. Now, I think we have to take a hard look at the interrogation techniques that are being used, and as a state attorney, to make sure that the physical evidence is also goes along with the confession.
Thank you. Candidate Perillo?
I learned in my brief tenure in the Navy that leadership is by example, and that's the type of leadership I will provide if elected to the office. I would intend to be the first person in the office in the morning and the last one out at night. Specifically with regard to this issue, I've touched upon it before. I would establish a conviction integrity unit. Unlike the organization as I understand it exists today, which is made up of volunteers, mine would be full-time, and there would be a full-time lawyer who I would bring in from outside of the office to run that unit. The unit would look at past cases for integrity of prosecution. The unit would look at current cases to ensure that past mistakes were not made, and the unit would engage in training. You cannot, there is no substitute for consistent, effective training, both in the office and outside the office, and that goes with any organization whatsoever. Training is the key, leadership is the key. That is what I would bring to the office.
Thank you. Candidate Perillo, you also answer this one first. The state's attorney's office is responsible for prosecuting criminal acts and for providing legal representation for Lake County and its elected officials. What would you do if discovered that those two goals were in conflict?
If I understand the question correctly, it is suggesting a hypothetical wherein the state's attorney's office would be defending a public official, and at some point in the case or in the litigation or perhaps in the investigation, it was determined that the public official broke the law, or at least there would be probable cause to think that the law had been broken. My response would be the law is paramount. My response would be that if a crime is suspected, an investigation needs to be made. If, because of a potential conflict of interest, the case needs to be referred out, I would immediately contact the Attorney General's office or whatever the appropriate outside prosecutorial agency would be. But again, to answer the question directly, enforcement of the criminal law is paramount, and that comes before any considerations of civil litigation or the adverse effect the prosecution might have on that civil litigation.
Thank you. Candidate Stanton?
Yes, I can conceive of several areas where there could be tension in that dual role of the state's attorney. One is, we were just talking about a moment ago, if you've got these wrongful prosecutions or cases like it that are moving in the pipeline now, that is also potentially an area that the state's attorney has to defend in a multi-million dollar lawsuit. I guess what we have to do in that case is look at the law as paramount, as Mr. Perillo said, and follow the law and be willing to even prosecute a prosecutor if that's what's called for. If that tension in the office, if that's too hard, maybe it's a case where you call in a special investigator, a special prosecutor, somebody from outside. But there are ways to do that.
Thank you, candidates. The next question, Candidate Stanton, you'll go first. What will you do to ensure Governor Rauner's overreach does not affect the most vulnerable in society?
I think the question calls for me to add some what overreach might be the most, but what I will do is address what we could do the most vulnerable in society, which is, I think, also a role that in the state's attorney's office. It's not a political office explicitly because we're not making law, but we are expressing the values, political values in our public policy. And I think by looking to incarcerate mentally ill people, people with drug problems, those sorts of things are wrong. And that's not what prison and incarceration is for. And we would address some of those things through the drug court or maybe through some other programs that we haven't. I've thought a good thing to do would be for the state's attorney's office to have an outreach in the schools, especially schools where you can correlate the zip code with the incarceration rate as they grow up.
Thank you. Perillo.
Thank you. I interpret the question as being one of a budgetary type nature, and we are not running for a legislative position. But having said that, to answer the question, I don't believe in spending somebody else's money. I am extraordinarily prudent in my own finances, and I would bring that to the state's attorney's office. In terms of overreach, when I hear that in a question, I'm immediately thinking of that which is going on in the legislature, the absence or presence of a budget, as it might be, and where your budgetary where the importance of your budgetary decisions are forwarded. In terms of the state's attorney's office, what I could bring to the table would be fiscal prudence. I would go over the budget constantly and make sure every penny was going to the appropriate and effective delivery of legal services here to the citizens of Lake County. That would include the criminal division, but also the civil division. I think we can do a lot of good things in saving money and being more effective in providing civil representation to the people.
Thank you, candidate. The next question, we'll start with you, Candidate Perillo. What sort of special care, if any, is required when dealing with crimes perpetrated by minors? Does this change when the victim is also a minor?
I think that's a rhetorical question. The answer is yes on both counts. We have a juvenile court system in which we certainly attempt to rehabilitate the juvenile offender. And in terms of juvenile victims, it is difficult for me to imagine anyone in a prosecutorial position who would not take every step possible to protect the child victim. My very first prosecution ever in the Navy was a child sex abuse case. That was 32 years ago. Since that time, I've also prosecuted child sex abuse type cases. And there's no substitute for the experience an attorney obtains in dealing with child victims and learning how to deal with those very sensitive victims.
Thank you. Candidate Stanton?
Well, I think that we do have a juvenile court that deals with teen perpetrators, and that's been for a long time set apart, but it had to be carved out of the law when it was developing in the late 1800s and the early 1900s across the country. For lesser crimes, we do have a teen court program that often involves where there's teen perpetrators and teen victims that keeps them out of the court and often imparts quite a lesson to the youngsters. And that's usually conducted by volunteer attorneys and volunteer judges. Other than that, I have great empathy for any victims of any kind, you know, having raised a family myself of children. And I think the state's attorney, it's a quality that would be admirable in the state's attorney's office to have a sensitivity to the youthful, the harm that can come from youthful victims.
Thank you. Candidate Stanton, you'll answer the next question first. What importance is there in communicating with the media about high-profile criminal proceedings?
Well, democracy is about transparency. And I think that light heals many things. Sunlight is good. I know that there's the state's attorney's office needs the room that they need to develop their theories and to prosecute to protect us. But given the sensitivity of the recent history of wrongful convictions, I think there has to be a special liaison from the state's attorney's office to work with the media so that the public trusts the process. Again, restoring trust, I think, is essential. There has to be accountability in the office, and I think that relations with the media are an extremely important part of that accountability factor.
I am a rules person. I follow the rules, I read the rules, I read the law, and as an attorney, my conduct is dictated by the rules and by the law. We have a code of professional conduct here in Illinois, and you can look that up, you could find it online. It prescribes that which a prosecutor can share with the press during the pendency of any proceeding. And what can be shared is very limited. The nature of the charge, the identity of the defendant, that sort of thing. But it's really quite limited. So quite frankly, while a case is pending, my instruction to staff and prosecutors would be simply to read the rule, understand the rule, and follow the rule.
Thank you. The next question will start with you. What can be done to prevent tragedies like the deaths of Logan McDonald, Sandra Bland, and Tamir Rice at the hands of the police?
You know, again, I get back to the function of leadership. I think it's a difficult question because we do have in this country, as we've seen, certain instances of police misconduct. By the same token, I think it is unfair to group any group of people and paint them with a broad brush. So what really needs to be done, in my opinion, is to look at each and every case for what it is and to have the courage to go forward with that case, depending upon what the evidence indicates and what the evidence says.
Tragedies is a good way to describe it. A lot of studies show in fast developing, low information situations like the police find themselves in those cases, that oftentimes what kicks in is, besides the natural fight and flight, there's a lot of confirmation bias and things like that that go in. I don't think we can talk about this without recognizing that there's minorities are the victims. Again, if I'm talking about something, I don't think there's outright prejudicial behavior, but there is confirmation bias that can play a part in this. It's usually not there in a more casual encounter with the officers. So I would say what we need to have is training, specific training for the police in those very intense situations.
Thank you, candidate. And you can hang on to the mic for our final audience question. Tell us about a time when you were unable to offer the legal help that was requested of you. What did you do?
A time I was unable to offer the legal help?
Correct.
Well, I don't have a specific instance that comes to mind, although there are many times when I have had somebody come to my office and there was something where the law just did not provide. Every human situation is not contemplated in the law. And in those cases, I would try and steer somebody to another area where they might be able to get the help, perhaps another professional, if that's appropriate. Otherwise, it would be to try and give them a way to think about it in their life. I mean, an attorney is a counselor at law, and there have been many times when I've drawn on my coursework in psychology, and which is the empathy for the people that I've been with.
Thank you.
I, in my life experience, have learned that in practicing law, you wear a number of different hats. First, foremost, and always, you're the attorney. But you wear the hat of counselor and sometimes mediator and sometimes even negotiator. When I think about the question, on the occasions where I couldn't help someone, it was typically because there was a conflict of interest. I perhaps could not help both the husband and wife in the same case. And what you do in that situation is to make that determination early on. And if necessary, you send the client to another qualified attorney, or perhaps you send both clients to two separate qualified attorneys. How does that relate to the state's attorney's office? We need to ensure that we do not run into conflicts of interest. And one of the things I proposed in the past is a no moonlighting policy in the office. If elected, I would prohibit attorneys from having outside employment outside of the office.
Thank you, candidates. And thank you, audience, for your thoughtful questions. At this time, we'll move to the closing comments. And I'd like to invite candidate Stanton to please come to the podium and make his final comments.
Oh, I think I was first on the intro.
Okay, then you will go second. Correct. Candidate Perillo.
Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for your questions and for your attendance. It's important for all of us to be informed about this and every election. This is going to be a very important election this year. Quite obviously, it's a presidential year. And all of you here will be, I believe, leaders in your different communities in terms of getting the word out as to the qualifications of the various candidates for the position for which they run. And I hope you'll take word from this forum as to what you heard from me, as to what you've heard from my qualifications, and as to what you've heard of my passion for the job. So again, thank you, and I thank the League, and I thank all of you for being here, and don't forget to get out and vote.
Thank you, Candidate Perillo. Candidate Stanton, your closing comments.
Thank you for coming. I echo Mr. Perillo's thanks to everybody and for your involvement. I think there's one theme that I have throughout this, and that's accountability. That's accountability to the taxpayers of Lake County for the tens of millions of dollars that we've seen this state's attorney's office that over the last decade and a half. Accountability to the citizens for public safety, for enforcing the law, for every wrongful conviction. Well, not everyone, but in a lot of cases, the real perpetrator is still going free. And accountability that the assistant state's attorneys have to the state attorney elected position. And it's that kind of leadership and that commitment that I offer to the voters.
Thank you. Thank you, candidates, for your willingness to serve, and thank you for your thoughtful responses today. And good luck with your campaigns. Audience, at this time, it's appropriate to join me in a round of applause for both of these candidates.
Thank you very much.
And all of you that might be watching at home, too, the League of Women Voters does want you to exercise your voice and your choice. There are more opportunities to get information at vote411.org. No matter where you live, put in your address. It will populate the information back to your polling place. You can get information to register to vote. You can get information on grace period voting. You can get information on the deadlines, voter qualifications. Just about anything you can think of, nonpartisan related, will be available for you. We do encourage that. And most importantly, take a friend to vote. Drive them to the polling places. Make sure, because this is the most important visible thing we can do as U.S. citizens, to get out and vote. And March 15th is the date for this primary election. And truly, we hope you exercise your right back in the fall for the primary election. Grace period and early voting are now underway, so do take that opportunity. And more importantly, drive safe and enjoy the rest of the spring-like weekend. And thanks for being here today.